This is the Literary License Podcast.
We're now on full automatic in the hands of the computers. That glorious paradox who sent me to the stars
still make war against his brother?
I can't help thinking somewhere in the universe there has to be something better than man.
I have always known about man. From the evidence, I believe his wisdom must walk hand in hand with his idiocy. His emotions must rule his brain. He must be a warlike creature who gives battle to everything around him, even himself.
Welcome to Literary License Podcast. My name is Keith Chawgo, and my other special co-stars are
Mandie Harvey,
Joshua Hyder,
and John Wilson. Thank you for joining us.
Our first item we're going to discuss is Page to Screen, where basically what we will do is we'll discuss upcoming features that will be coming to your screen based on books. And John, do you want to let us know what you come up with?
Sure, yeah. So we have a few lovely adaptations coming out. There's one called Postal, which is on Hulu, which is a comic book series created by Matt Hawkins, Brian Hill, and Isaac Goodhart that they developed in 2015. Also, there's some theatrical releases that are coming out. I'm really excited about the new It adaptation that's coming out from the original adaptation series, which was in 1995, I think, right?
Yes.
And as well as there's another book called The Snowman that is getting an adaptation that is coming out in October 20th of this year, which stars Michael Fassbender, which I'm really excited about as well, a novel published by Norwegian author Jo Nesbø. So we're really excited about that as well. Anyone else want to add any other adaptations coming?
I'm actually pretty excited for Death Note coming out to Netflix. That's super, it's kind of different, but I mean, it's supposed to be a huge, huge, huge thing for Netflix. So, and it has...
Netflix is doing a lot of great things at the moment, so...
Yeah, but I was pretty sure that Death Note used to be like a comic first, correct? And then they kind of made that into a... actual anime, and then it was a movie or a show. Sorry.
Yeah, kind of like The Matrix, because that was along the same line, but then they went full feature on that one.
Right. So I'm pretty excited for that.
I'm not terribly excited about anything, to be honest.
Well, I'm actually excited about. There's a couple of adaptions coming out, and they're actually both directed by Mike Flanagan, who came out with the movie Hush, which is on Netflix at the moment, and Oculus.
Ooh, that's a good one.
They're actually doing a 10-part series based on The Haunting of Hill House by Shirley Jackson. Nice. And they got Michelle Guzman from Game of Thrones coming in to play the part of Stephen Crane, which looks like they're going back into the whole history of Hill House. So you're going to get a precursor to everything that's going on later on. And Carla Gugino, or Gugino? Carla Gugino? I think joining the Gugino, cast as well. But another thing that Mike Flanagan's doing for Netflix is Stephen King's Gerald's Game with Carlo Gugino as well. And that should be out later on in the fall. So
nice.
There's some good stuff coming out at the moment.
Aren't we, you know, as a precursor, covering The Haunting of Hill House? So it's
kind
of,
you know,
hint, hint, we'll be talking about that soon.
Yes.
Another one also is Mr. Mercedes. He's finally, Stephen King's finally bringing that to the big screen. So that's also going to be another good one to check out as well.
Now, is Mr. Mercedes, my Stephen King, later Stephen King's is a little bit hazy, but didn't Joe, is that the same kind of story that Joe Hill did with Nosferatu? Or is that?
Almost, yeah.
So they kind of,
yeah. A little bit, yeah. It's going to be more serial killer based. So it's going to be kind of, it's going to be maybe like a, I don't know, movie version of Dexter, who knows, with Stephen King. Anything is possible.
Kind of interested for the new Blade Runner, to see how they do with that. Because the original will kind of be tough to beat. Just the whole kind of the scope of the movie, the way that it kind of led off a whole kind of series of those types of movies, and also the tone of the movie. It'll be interesting to see if they can match that. Kind of that. It seemed like they were raining the whole movie in that one for some reason.
Yeah. Well, I saw the, there's a, I did the blog for what's up and coming in the cinema for the next 3 months, and Blade Runner 2049 did come up on it. And from the trailer, it looks like looks like a lot of sun. It's a lot brighter. So
yeah,
I'm not quite, you know, what sure. The director is quite a good director. I can't remember his name at the moment, but he's got a lot of good accomplishments under his belt, and they are using, you know, the source material to scope off it. So it looks like they're going to use what they didn't use in Blade Runner from the source material into this movie. So, but, you know, with most things, you'll just have to wait and see how the end product comes out.
Yeah, I guess the team on that's going to do Dune next.
Yeah.
That will be interesting to see what they do with it, because I love that film. The
David Lynch version.
Yeah, the David Lynch movie. It just does not explain Frank Herbert's work at all, just because it's like a dictionary. Mm-hmm. I mean, the original book is like a dictionary, and it kind of reads like it. But I like the movie, what they did with it, but you didn't really get the full effect of the story in the movie.
Well, another thing is that if the film is successful, if let's say Dune does very well, that means the other books will come in line as well.
Yeah,
and that's, you know, and at the moment, that's what most cinemas are looking for, is, you know, the whole serial experience sort of thing.
Yeah.
You know, future installments. So they might this time actually try to get it right, because I think David Lynch's suffered basically. They try to shove everything into one movie.
Exactly.
And
then they have those kind of that expositional dump at the beginning of the film. It's like, I'll tell you this story for 20 minutes. Okay, when can we get the movie going here? And what I missed was the intrigue of the houses. In the book, the houses meant a lot more than they did in the film. You know, to be in the different, you know, Atreides' house and Harkonnen house and all that, it meant a lot more.
Well, I think with Game of Thrones now, you know, because, I mean, you know, with its popularity on television, and has actually proven to a lot of studios that the multi-complex stories of different things going on at different times, that the audience now can keep up with that sort of thing. And it looks like the films are starting to actually pick up on that. So they're not trying to streamline it to the dumb anymore because of television, which is probably the first time that television's actually foreran for films.
Right.
So do we have anything else to add about page to screen section?
The only one that I forgot to mention was Death Wish, which I find very interesting that they're bringing back that genre. I mean, not genre, but that story, because they did, what, five, I think, movies that was with Charles Bronson. But it's this time it's with Bruce Willis. So that is actually
pretty good.
Coming out in November 22nd of this year.
So. My old colleague is directing it, Eli Roth.
Nice.
Oh, so, nice. That's awesome.
And Eli, isn't he also doing the adaptation of It, right? Is he doing It? Or no, he's not doing It.
No, he's not doing it. He wants to do another remake of Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street. I think he's doing that one. Nice.
Which he can just stop,
so.
Well, I have to sit there and say, this is kind of going off point about Pace of Screen, but Leatherface, I was kind of poo-pooing that. It's like, oh, here we go sort of thing. But the directors that are directing it are the same directors as the French horror films Inside and Vivid.
It's going to be insane.
So it's going to, and looking at the trailer, it's going to be very beautiful, very gory, but very beautiful to look at. So
yeah,
I'm excited.
And it looks like it's going back to sort of the origin, like a true origin story of that character. So
really, and normally, well, I mean, even if you look at the Chainsaw films anyway, they're normally quite kind of bland looking as far as the way they're filmed. They're all filmed like documentary, but you know, with this, these two new directors coming in, I mean, it's going to have a beauty to it. It's going to be like beauty gore.
You know, yeah,
they really have a thing at that.
Yeah, so, it's pretty good.
So, and that brings us down to forming the plot. Now, the reason why this episode is about Planet of the Apes, which is based on the Pierre Boulle's book, Planet of the Apes, and which later became the 1968 classic film. Now, the reason why we picked Planet of the Apes mainly was because War of the Planet of the Apes coming out and becoming a huge hit. And another reason is because Planet of the Apes actually means something special to me. When I was a kid, after my parents divorced, and CBS, you know, we were living, just my mom and my two sisters and myself, and my cousins were living with us as well. And CBS showed the Planet of the Apes series 1, 2, and 3. And as a child, I was like really into the Planet of the Apes. I had the action figures. I had the Ape City. I watched the CBS TV show that came on later. And then later on was the animated series, which was on ABC. I was really into the Ape series. And then puberty hit and I kind of forgot about it. Then what happens is in 1986, I moved over to England. And in England, you could buy videos. Instead of renting videos, you bought the videos. And one of the first video sets I bought was Planet of the Apes. And not seeing since I was a kid, I've started watching these films and started getting something totally out of these this series of films. Then, of course, Tim Burton's Planet of the Apes came out. I was very excited, but not that excited after I saw it, unfortunately. And then the DVD came out, and then the Blu-rays came out. So, you know, and every time I watch the series, I pick up more and more on it. The more mature I become, the more I seem to get out of Planet of the Apes. So this is the reason why Planet of the Apes is our first episode. Our next section is page to page. And to start the discussion, Mandy, what did you find about the book? What did you like about it?
I had to read it twice just because I do have a child. So, but I do like how they kind of went a little slowly into the ape and man flipping reversal roles. I found it absolutely interesting how there could just be just this random planet where now humans are getting a taste of, so to speak, their own medicine with experimentation and being on the animal side. It was an easy read. It was really interesting, and then that actually got me into going into and watching the movie because I had not seen it. So I am now a fan of the Planet of the Apes. So, hooray!
I mean, I found the book rather strange. I mean, I found it interesting, but I don't know whether it's the French translation from the French into English, but I found it a bit, there always seemed to be like a third wall going on where there doesn't seem to be a lot of emotions going on. The narrator for me, Ulysses, just seems to be just taking it all in his stride, just like another day in paradise. And, but yeah, I found it, I mean, the themes I found were very, very good. I like, you know, the different,
it's interesting.
Yeah, and I like the role reversals that it actually was a mirror to, so for us to reflect you know, mankind and, you know, in the mirror image.
I do have a question, though. Do you think that Ulysses made the right choice to reveal that he could actually talk and have a conversation in front of the apes or chimps?
I think in this case, it really didn't matter because there was that the distinction of language difference. So I don't think they even understood that he could speak another language. Right. Which we'll talk about, like, that distinction with the movie and how that contrasts differently. I think what you come across is that the character, he's the unreliable narrator because he kind of lets himself come into the story a lot. When that's being read back, you have to keep going back and saying he's telling us the story, and we get, well, these are the facts. And this is my opinion on the facts. So you kind of go in between that those two things, you know. Well, but I don't think
But two, he's an anomaly, though. So it's basically he's just one. That's what Dr. Zauis basically says, is that he's just a smarter human. He's not anything different than these animals that we have locked up here. He's just kind of a smarter dog, basically. So to them, it didn't make any difference whether he could talk or jump up and down or stand on his head or whatever. He was going to be a human, but just maybe a little different human.
Yeah, but I also think, like, if you think of a cat meows at you, you know, it's a different language. So you can go, like, how cute, but it could be, like, telling you to go F off, you know? Like, so you kind of, I think with this, the distinction is like, he tried that approach thinking, oh, I'm going to get some engagement, and they're just kind of like, what are you talking about? You know, and he had to learn about doing the geometry, right? Yeah, and doing geometry in a different way, that science is something that's engaging, right? And so once he was able to do that, he caught their attention. I think that's a bigger, I guess the question is, you know, taking that step to show he is a logical being, that, yeah, that's a huge risk because he doesn't know where that's going to get him.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, it seems like the international language always tends to be math, whether it's geometry or algebra or numerical. But that seems to be the...
Well, isn't that what they send out? They kind of, one of the, from astronauts, they send something out, and it is something to do with geometry. There's a specific shape and diagram that is, like, universal because it is, like, the square and the triangle and the circle, and it's like basically showing that we're an intelligent race.
Yeah, so it's just, you know, I thought that was quite clever the way Pierre Boulle was able to start the conversation between Ulysses and Zira, because, you know, yeah, I guess, you know, it showed that his character, the main character, Ulysses, was quite intelligent. I mean, he kind of knew he was intelligent, but it showed that, you know, he tried a bunch of different things. And I liked in the book the way that, you know, he tried this, that didn't work, went to the next thing, and then went to the next thing. And it was like a slow process for him to be able to communicate. And I thought that was quite well done in the book.
Yeah. And he kind of, again, because he is the narrator of the story, he talks about the frustration of... It's almost like having to say hello in 15 different languages, because you're trying to be like, hello, hello, and just be patient with that. You kind of get to hola, and then that's understood, you know. So,
I mean, I think Ulysses' main problem, I mean, I think to me, he comes across as quite conceited. And even after he, you know, he progresses back into their civilization and starts to merge himself in and assimilate himself to the culture that he's found himself in. But for some reason, he always thinks he's something slightly better than they are. Yeah. And I mean, unlike the film, I'm not sure if our listeners are familiar with the book, but the ape society is very modernized in the book. I mean, they have, you know, they got science, they got automobiles, they got, you know, planes, you know, and so they're very, very technically advanced, you know.
But now, not too technologically advanced, because that's sort of where his superiority comes into, in saying that they should be more advanced because humans are more advanced and they're not quite there yet.
But then again, but as you said before, he's a false narrator, and it's almost, you know, and I know, like, with humans, when they go to a different country, they have a sit there and saying, like, well, You know, the thing here is when we get Americans coming to the UK, they go, well, they don't have what we have. You know, America's better because England doesn't have, you know,
this,
a hot dog. You know what I mean? Yeah. And, you know, and English people say that when they probably go to America. You know, well, English people go to Greece. And the main thing is they just don't do good fish and chips here. You know, and I know this is tearing it down to basic terms here. But there's always that comparison that home is always going to be better. But
right.
And the thing is, it's, even though they are, you know, he's in a spaceship, but we're not really quite sure how technically advanced the human race is because Ulysses never really tells us how technically advanced they are. We're meant to assume it. And the way he acts assumes that he is.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, I think the only thing that keeps the apes behind is basically their religion. And there is that thing where religion's keeping the science down to a certain extent. So maybe that's why. But as far as technology is concerned, they seem to be, you know, headed in the same directions as humans are. I mean, they don't have space flight. Well, we don't think they have space flight.
Until the end, yeah.
Until the very end. So maybe they do have space flight. But they do have space flight because at the end of the story, isn't that where Ulysses and Nova escape into the spaceship and they look like any other human?
Yeah.
So obviously they do have space flight.
The other thing that they seem to, something that he kind of, he doesn't really, I guess, notice is that there is this class system that is inexistent there that is causing a sort of utopian society. No one really fights that. You know, the orangutans, they are sort of the keepers of knowledge and religion. And you have the chimpanzees who are science and sort of philosophers. And then you have the gorillas who are like the grunt and the security, right, for the villages. But it all seems to work and no one really fights that. And you don't sort of read that through in anyone protesting and saying, oh, you know, I'm a chimpanzee and I want to be a gorilla or whatever. It's what the disruption is the human. You know, whenever there is conflict that is within that community, it's you know, Ulysses who's causing the conflict. So he never really mentions what he feels about that because there is this, again, moral superiority of like we are, you know, man is so much better, you know, because we are more advanced. And, you know, it gets into that sort of later in the book when there is that moment between him and Cornelius when they're reviewing the sites where they find the doll. And it is sort of this, oh, well, you know, you learn from us, you know, we are the ones who taught you how to be logical and have emotions and all these things. And it becomes almost like maybe it's my mission to bring humans back to that place of stature, you know.
But big difference to me, or the big thing in the book with him was that he wanted to fit in with the apes. I mean, he was willing to put himself into their society. He didn't isolate himself. He put the suit on and he got his house and he became one of them and lived like they did. It was only until the child was born that he saw as a way to get humans back to being on top, kind of, and so did Dr. Zauis. And that's why they had to go away, because they would have been murdered. But he was willing. He was very friendly with Cornelius and Zira.
Yeah.
They were really his friends. And he felt to them like a human would feel about his friends.
Yeah.
Well, I think that, you know, in the part of Zira in the book, especially, I mean, the thing is she considered him an intellectual equal. I mean, the thing is when she develops feelings for him, she doesn't develop feelings because, oh, he's my pet. She developed feelings because he was an intellectual equal to her. You know, this man, you know, this species, you know, is like my species. He's intelligent. He's got a bright mind, you know. And so he was no longer an animal. He was actually equal to her.
Yeah.
And so that.
And it's also something she was always looking for. That's what her studies was. If you think about scientists who approaches animals, and it's not about just testing on them to better ourselves. It's about really trying to tap into something, into an animal that you can logically communicate with them and have an exchange of logic and knowledge. And so for her, it's sort of her mission to find that, and she found it, you know, and that's huge for her, because it's also her life work, and which also kind of is sad, because then that's sort of almost taken away from her when Dr. Zauis gets involved, because she now has this holy grail and it's going to get ripped away from her.
I mean, the funny thing about the whole situation is that because Ulysses is, you know, an odd narrator to the piece anyway, and when they have that tender moment between Zira and him, and the thing is you don't know how much of it's actually, because I mean, he's actually, you know, enforcing the way he thinks onto Zira when he's writing about her. So you don't really know that, does she find him emotionally attractive, or does he think that she finds him emotionally attractive?
Yeah. That's true. That's very true. Because Nova, from his point of view,
It's the same with Nova. He gives her a lot of people, like, my cat loves me and we have the best friends, you know. Well, cats aren't your best friends.
Yeah,
they have those human characteristics that you give to them. And that's what he did with her. He gave her more human characteristics than she actually had, and it was through his eyes that you saw her. So whenever he says, "Oh, she's becoming more human," maybe he just didn't want to be embarrassed that he was having sex with an animal anymore.
I think he also, like his most of his relationships, Ulysses flip-flopped in how he felt about them, because at one point he compared her to a sister, and then to Nova, to a sister, and then from a sister to, well, she's kind of pretty, but she's still an animal, and then to, oh, you know, she's very attractive, and he kind of does that with all of the characters. He does that with Zira, and in the sense of finding something that's intriguing about her, but not really knowing what it is. And, you know, but she's an animal, and of course I can't be, you know, it'd be in love with something like that, but yet she's attractive. So you kind of like, he always kind of hopped around on that, you know.
I'm thinking that the chimp was looking pretty good after being in space for a while. So
the chimp didn't last that long. So
chimp. So he just kind of put Zira's face on the other chimp or something.
Yeah.
You know how long they're in space.
That poor chimp did not survive past like age 10. I mean, poor Nova choked that baby out, and it was a bad little moment. But we find out why later, of course. It's obvious because terrified of apes. And
well, I mean, the funny thing about it is just like, you know, I don't know what Pierre Boulle was thinking here, but, you know, with the chimp situation, I mean, it's like, you know, the chimp's along, and it's like, oh, he's our best friend. You know, he's our pet. We love him dearly. He's the best thing, you know, since sliced bread. You know, he's one of us. The chimp runs off. They go for a skinny dip. The chimp dies. He's like, oh, she killed it. And it's like, so this beloved pet has died. And I mean, I'm sorry, but I've had pets that die. And, I mean, it took me a while to get over it. It wasn't like, Oh, yeah.
Well, anyway. Well, but was he beloved? Because I feel like if you think of the space exploration in that time, in the 80s specifically too, they used it as, well, let's see if it survives in different, you know, atmospheres. Yeah. You know, and it was kind of like, well, I guess that atmosphere is not really good. It was. I don't think it was meant to be like, hey, it's her best buddy.
Well, the thing is, but the way it's described in the book, it does kind of come across that, because the thing is like the chimp's with them, you know, and when you put animals in space, you put them in the space subjects, and then if they come back alive, and then you put the humans on there. It's okay, well, but you don't bring the monkey on with the human. It's just like,
forget his name was actually Hector.
One-on-one thing with Nova and the chimp, they were the same, right? Both of them were animals, and one animal killed the other animal. So maybe he was thinking that would be something where, you know, that would be an equal kind of thing. Is that this? How I feel about this animal is the way I feel about her. So.
Yeah, well,
she could have also, in defense, she probably killed it because she thought she was protecting other humans.
Exactly.
Like, you know, it wasn't like an aggressive, like, I'm going to choke this thing out because I can. It's more like, hey, I have some fellow humans that I just found and I want to protect them and I'm going to, you know, kill this creature.
And I have to sit there and say, I mean, as far as the chimp is concerned, I mean, I think The only reason why I say that there is a bit more emotion about the chimp, because the chimp goes off and they don't know where he is, and they're and you know, in those 10 pages that Hector is in the book, and then they're you know, there's quite a few things about them being quite concerned about what happened to Hector, and then when Hector comes, they are so happy that he's come there. I mean, they're hugging him and squeezing him, and then Nova, of course, chokes the chicken with him. Well, not choke the chicken, but choke the monkey.
Choke the monkey. What just happened here? We changed dialogue here. What's going on?
Sorry.
A whole different movie.
Do we already hop to the pawn scene already? Like this quickly?
Yeah.
Planet of the porn, but I mean, and they killed him. And I don't know. It was kind of just a weird, you know, situation, because I mean, they were horrified that Hector was murdered by Nova, but at the same time, it's kind of like, but then it's like, oh well. And then they moved on, and then they continue playing seal games with the naked humans. You know, it's like, you know, otter, you know, they just, the whole scene just reminded me of a bunch of otters. You know, it's just like, you know, the otter comes and they all go chasing them, and they chase them back, and they just play their otter games in the water with the other humans. And yeah, so I can understand why, you know, Pierre would use Hector as actually, you know, it's actually a foreshadowing of what's to come sort of thing.
Right. But yeah, that's kind of what I thought too.
But I just found the whole emotional thing about Hector's death was like, well, you get this build up to Hector and their concerns, and then when he dies, like, oh well, here we go.
Yeah.
Anyway, well, carrying on.
Chapter 4.
Hector is also a lot like Stuart, which we'll talk about later about in the film, because it was an expendable character for a reason.
He's Richard.
So, you know.
At least Hector had a few more pages in him.
Yeah. And got to at least, it got to
been true in number five. You know? Yeah. Number five, point your weapon. You're done.
But I did find, I mean, you know, with Pierre Boulle, you know, fighting in World War II, and I mean, there are, you know, you can tell that he was raised Catholic and that, you know, he later became agnostic and stuff like this. But, I mean, there's a lot of biblical references. I mean, with the, you know, the whole Nova and Ulysses' baby, you know, it's a bit like the Jesus Christ figure, you know, that, you know, let's say that he did live, and let's say that child did grow up, I mean, he would probably become some kind of Jesus-like figure if they stayed on the planet. And so, you know, they had to scoot off. And Ulysses thinks himself as Moses, really. You know, he's going to be the savior of the human race. He's going to be, like Moses was with the Jews, you know. You know, I mean, I think there are plans for him to actually just take all the humans and find his own promised land somewhere along the way.
He does become like very Messiah, especially after the dig, the archaeology dig, because he kind of just realizes like, wait, I was right. Like humans were more, you know, the first and like came here. But what happened? And the thing that's interesting too is he is a journalist, so that character is more of a journalist than a scientist. So he kind of was looking for the answers, and now that he's getting the pieces and putting them together, it clicks in his brain that maybe I'm the one to lead my people back. You know.
Well, another thing is, I mean, Ulysses does have a messiah's complex anyway. He thinks he's going to save everyone.
Yeah.
You know, there's always that feeling, you know, which is kind of, you know, and maybe that's, maybe it explains this tone of the film with him being a journalist. And, you know, he is standing, there's, you know, a journalist, when they do report, they are standing back from what's going on, and they don't really, he's part of the story, but he's more of an observer of the story.
Yeah. And, which was a little annoying, because I felt like in the beginning, I just found it weird that all these men were just kind of letting things happen to them. But then when you take that into account, you kind of realize, you know, journalists, that's what they do. They watch, they observe the culture. And there's a bunch of, you know, a bunch of creatures and other things that are there that they're just kind of like, you know, I would be freaking the hell out. I personally would be like, I'm not going to let you touch my belongings. I'm not going to let you touch my, like, they had weapons, and they kind of just let them play with the weapons. And, oh, they destroyed them. Oh, well.
Carry on.
You have to take that into account, that it's a journalist. It's a point of view that they're observing, not meaning to disrupt that culture until it disrupts them. And then that's when there's sort of a retaliation.
Well, the scientist character just basically goes numb. I mean, doesn't he go a bit catatonic?
Yeah, you know? He reverts. He reverts because it's
a zoo.
Yeah.
Comes a zoo animal.
Yeah. But I think it's because he's analytical as well, isn't he? He's so
was it Professor Anatel, or was it... Okay.
Because it wasn't Arthur, because Arthur died, right?
Yeah, Arthur got shot down.
Yeah.
R.I.P. Arthur.
Yeah, sorry, Arthur. You were a good character for 1 minute.
But the professor, I mean, I think with the professor, I mean, I always think of the professors that he probably has everything in such an order. Everything has to make sense. And I think that's the reason why he went to the catastrophic stage is that he saw something that doesn't make sense that shouldn't be happening. And that's, he just shut down.
I think it's also you got to take into account was his, he was the one that in the beginning actually made that comment like, you know, we're leaving behind Earth because man kind of destroyed it, right? We're going out here to explore because something else better has to exist. Well, you did find something, but is it better? And that could make anyone go crazy because then you go, you be careful what you wish for, right? So you, I think that also fractured him because what he thought would be better was actually worse, you know?
I also found it a bit weird because another thing is that they didn't crash land on Betelgeuse. They landed on Betelgeuse. Yeah. The ship was 100% they can go on at any time, and they never chose to go.
No, because they tore it apart and they let them. That's what I'm saying.
They tore the ship apart.
They land and then it's sort of like they're, while they're kind of trying to figure out what these humanoids are, the humanoids are just breaking shit apart and they're just kind of like watching them do it and they're tearing their ship apart and they're watching them do it. And I think, I don't know, I feel like, I don't know if that was just because they have a law or an order that like okay, whatever they want to do, it's fine because we don't want to disrupt their natural surroundings. But yeah, it was weird. It was really weird to me.
Yeah.
Well, was
that your only mode of getting back? I mean, why would you just watch them? But then again, you never, you know, as I said before, since we hit, because he is a false narrator, you're never really sure exactly how many humans are we talking about? Are there 20, 50, 100, 150?
And we tend to exaggerate as storytellers. We tend to say, oh my God, there was 500 humanoids and there was 20. You know, and it's, I think in this is like, you know, did they want to come back? Because that's another thing is like, weren't they just coming to be on another planet, you know, or was it something like, hey, it's a trip here and then we're going to, you know, go back home and tell the story, right?
Mm-hmm. It was a literary device that you had to have it destroyed so that he wouldn't have any hope of leaving, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you had to have it destroyed somehow. So that was it. It was kind of like the same idea when he went to the institute where they're doing the brain things people's brains. That was just the device to tell you the backstory.
It was an epilogue, how to do it.
Became more and when humans digressed. That was really shaky way of telling that. It could have been told a way better way, but it was a device. Because in storytelling, sometimes you just have to get somewhere. And
I also think that them destroying everything is, again, it's a key theme that man destroys, right? So in letting man destroy their only way home, it's sort of like, hello, look what's happening here. And it's another marker to be like, this is one way man destroys, you know, and then later on it does it again to where you realize this is a recurring pattern here. And that's why I think the apes they want to control the environment and make sure that they don't pick up those traits of man, because ultimately they know it'll lead to their own destruction.
I did find it another strange thing about the book is that when Pierre Boulle switched the roles with apes becoming the humanized characters and the humans becoming the animal, the ape characters, really is that he made sure that the humans actually took on the life of chimpanzees and gorillas. You know, the nest that they were in, they grouped in family groupings and they groomed each other like apes did. And everything was done very ape-like for the humans, like insisting that if in a Darwin chain, that if we did, you know, come from apes, that, you know, if we didn't have that change, and let's say the apes became the fairy, that the humans would take on the ape colony sort of formations of families and groups and sticking together.
Yeah. And the apes also, like in this story, actually maintain more of their mammalian like style, like versus like we'll talk about in the movie. It's, you know, they're very much
four hands, basically, so they can use their feet as hands to pick and move things and stuff. So I found that was very interesting too, that they just evolved as opposed to like physically completely involved into more of a male, like, I guess, that what they call it, primordial, like humanoid, I guess.
Primordial. I mean, what I did like about Pierre Boulle, equations of the humans is like, I did like that you found out what happened with the children, how they treated the children. They were like the petting zoo, and then you had the adults were like in the cages, and they used them for science experimentation and vice versa.
Or there's also the banger chapter, you know, which I call it, which is, you know, hey, we're gonna watch them figure out how they make babies.
Yeah, let's watch them copulate.
Oh, lovely chapter 14, you know.
Yeah. And I did find it weird also that Pierre Boulle had the humans doing a dating ritual, basically, a mating ritual. Not a dating ritual, but a mating ritual where they would do this little dance. Which, I guess the modernized humans that we are today, we probably do a bit of a dance, but it's a bit more of a, you know, talking thing. It's not so much of a, you know, birds of paradise out in the jungle sort of thing, kind of mating dance. Which I thought that was quite interesting, that the way he, you know, put that into the story sort of thing, that there's the wild humans had this neat ritual mating dance. Yeah. Or they got down and dirty.
Yeah. Yeah.
What about, how did you find the ending? I found the ending a bit odd, actually.
In fact, I don't know. I think it was lacking some stuff, too, because, like, they just up and leave. That's...
It felt rushed, and it also felt a little confusing. I think I had talked to you, Keith, about this before, that I wasn't really sure if they even left the planet or if they went back home, and then the home was also like their home, because it was kind of this weird, you know, thing where I wasn't sure if their Earth had evolved that way too, and was it because that planet somehow colonized their planet? So it was kind of a little disjointed that way for me.
There's one paragraph that says that when they come back into the solar system, they pass the planets Neptune, Saturn, you know, they pass those planets, and then they see Earth off in the distance.
So they did,
right? Because he says that when he first saw the sun for the Earth, he knew it when he was getting close to home, right?
Yeah, because I know that they mentioned, I guess, that place Sonar had like three suns, and that was just confusing to me, because I was like, so they come back to Earth and there's Ape, but then why? Like, versus, you know, it's just that.
Because he's saying that in time, all humans would become apes. That's what he's saying, basically.
Or being enslaved.
For EMC squared, right? Because they were gone from Earth for so long that Earth had become taken over by apes for the same reason that it had back on the Beetlejuice planet, basically, was that man had destroyed themselves and the apes had taken over. So it was the same difference.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I like the Twilight Zone ending with the last chapter being that it was the whole time that the story's being read by, I mean, I don't know how big this bottle was, because...
Spring bottles.
There's a whole novel inside of it.
No, it's like a giant Poland spring bottle that they just put a whole like Bible in there. Like, here, read this story.
But you do find out that Jin and Jin's mate, can't remember his name, sorry. But
Phyllis.
Jin and Phyllis. Yeah.
Jin and Phyllis.
And you find out that they're chimps. At the whole time, and of course they don't believe the story. They think, oh, this is going to bus tops. But then it brings me back to the simple fact that, you know, which I cannot ever get my head around, and I've read this book three or four times throughout my lifespan here, and when I ever get to the ending, it's that they land on Earth, and it ends with basically they're being encircled. And then we go back to Jin and Phyllis from the prologue, and I always think to myself, is like, when does, you know, at what point did your listeners put a bottle in the space for them to actually get the manuscript?
I mean, I thought that he just
blow
like,
it out there.
Yeah, no, I thought like maybe it was when they were escaping. Maybe he was like, "I'm gonna throw this out into space." But why?
He
like,
told the rest of the story, like, though. That would make sense if he didn't give you the big reveal at the end.
No, but yeah. I'm saying, did he throw that out when they were going back to Earth? Like,
he couldn't have because he told you what happened on Earth. So he would have gone back into space and throw it somewhere.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
excuse me, I need to return to space, please. I gotta throw this away.
Yeah,
exactly. Space junk.
And I also thought one thing to bring up too is I thought that because they kind of explained that Jen and Phyllis live this sort of elite yacht where they're sunbathing with the suns and all that. I thought that was very interesting because it's a very different take of the apes that are on the planet that we get to see, you know? And so is it, they have become even more evolved and more elite and more material, because I think one of them says something very materialistic and I was like, well, that's interesting. And yeah. Mm. But it's a very interesting. That's, and I didn't think about that. I didn't think about the how, you know. I thought about, I wonder how he got it out there, but I didn't think that he threw it out or had to have thrown it out some point after they got back to Earth. Like, so there is another story, and why didn't he tell that story? And why is that it not in that bottle? You know.
Yeah, I mean, because at some point he had to go back up in space.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And yeah, then but just from a writing perspective, it kind of laid an egg pretty hard. Because it was like the last page that was, you know, usually you climb to the top and then the good old French word denouement, right? Denouement, there it is. And then, you know, you go to the ending. It was just like, well, we skipped that part.
Yeah. Well, it was also fast. It was also fast, even how they got out and how they just got lucky and they got out and all that stuff. I thought that was just so rushed and fast. That it didn't give you enough time to go, what's going on here? You know, like, and because I feel like the descent down into the planet, you get to see the mountains, you get to see that, like, you get to see everything that descend down, but they way up, it's like, and they're back home, and there's the Eiffel Tower, and then, like, you know, like, what?
Yeah, and as I said before, and then back to, you know, that wraparound where you come back to the beginning, and, you know, and you got this strange thing about this bottle with, you know, at least, I don't know, 800 pieces of paper in it. Yeah, and and a handwritten, of course, because I don't think it was typed. But, and then it's like, well, how did they get this piece of paper? But I mean, at some point, I scoured the net for, you know, the reasoning behind it. So I thought maybe there's like some kind of hidden message here. Maybe it's some kind of parable that I didn't catch up on, but...
Wouldn't have been interesting if it was written by Dr. Zira. That would have been interesting. Like, she was telling the story. I thought about that too, because I wondered, what if that was, because he is very unreliable, that I just didn't trust him. So Ulysses, as much as I wanted to, I just didn't trust what he was trying to say and what he was trying to do. But Zira, I would have. I think it would have been an interesting story to then read this and have them go, oh, she's crazy. Like, she doesn't know what she's talking about. Like, she did not have some human who could talk. No way. But you would have been like, you know, at least more believable in her story, you know, and understanding or trusting her story.
Mm. Yeah, no, I totally agree. So is there anything else anyone wants to add about La Planète du Singe? Pierre Boulle's book. I'm sure I massacred the French on that one. So, and ready for the commercial break.
Unlike certain Hollywood celebrities, we can't in good conscience endorse a product unless we actually use it and like it. Fortunately, the literary licensed podcast family have been loyal customers of Amazon for, at least a decade in my case. Not only does Amazon have a wide selection of pretty much anything that a body could need, they also have the best customer service of any online merchant. So from ping pong balls to bathtubs, you can find it all on Amazon. And if it qualifies for Prime shipping, you can get it in 2 days or less. In case you didn't know, Amazon Prime is a service that not only cuts your shipping cost, but you also receive a free year subscription to their online streaming service. I just finished binge watching the Amazon original series Sneaky Pete that was co-created with the incomparable Bryan Cranston. I have to say, honestly, that I would pretty much watch Bryan Cranston paint his house. But I will recommend the series because it was truly fun to watch. It was well written and equally well acted, and it was a good time. And for all the fans of the show, those of you that have already seen it, it's got picked up for a second season, and it will be coming back. So we can look forward to that. Just one last little note about Prime. If your family qualifies for EBT here in the United States, I don't know what they call it in Britain, but in the United States, the fee for the service is cut from $100 a year to just $5.99 a month. So that is an extra savings for those that may not have as much money as others, which is nice. So,
I mean, Amazon's a great company. I mean, all the books and all the DVDs and all the Blu-rays and everything that we'll be discussing through the show, you can buy your own copies through Amazon. And I have to sit there and say, I have Amazon Prime myself, and we get Preacher and we got American Gods on Amazon Prime in the UK. And yeah, I use Amazon. It's like my favorite place to shop. So
yeah, mine too.
Yep. Ditto. So
from everything from A to Z, shop Amazon.
Yes. That's
where I'm getting my wedding dress.
And if you Amazon in the United States, it's www.amazon.com. In the UK, it's www.amazon.co.uk. And if you're in Australia, just www.amazon.au.
Can't help thinking that somewhere in the universe there has to be something better than man. Has to be.
The words are Charlton Heston's.
Get out of that signal! The words, and we've landed!
The world he finds out in the galaxy will challenge every idea you've ever had of civilization. A planet where man is the lowest order of living things, and the superior beings are apes. They build the cities, make the laws, the gods, and control the guns that hunt a race of lowly, terrified humans who run wild in the jungle, are caged in the prisons, and stuffed in the museums. 20th Century Fox transforms the motion picture screen into Planet of the Apes. Pierre Boulle's finest novel since Bridge on the River Kwai.
The world gone insane. An upside-down civilization could not be real. Yes, a world of madness, terror.
Man has no understanding. He can be taught a few simple tricks, nothing more.
You did it. Cut up his brain, you bloody baboon. It's a madhouse! It's a madhouse! It did not end here. It ended in an episode so unpredictable, so shocking, that it meant a horror which preceded it seemed calm and gentle as a summer's night. Great many people worked long and hard to answer the question of what a civilization would be like where the evolutionary process had been reversed and apes were the superior species. Hundreds of technicians and the largest number of makeup artists have assembled, assisted the producers, the writers, the director, and the cast. Dr. Cornelius, Robbie McDowell. Dr. Zira is played by Kim Hunter. Dr. Zauis is portrayed by Maurice Evans. And Nova by Linda Harrison.
Now the tribunal has placed you in my custody for final disposition. You realize what that means. Now, emasculation to begin with. Then experimental surgery on the speech centers, on the brain. Eventually, a kind of living death.
Planet of the Apes, beyond your wildest dreams.
A section we called screen testing, and Mandy's with us today to discuss the synopsis of the film.
Hi, Hi, everybody. So, The Planet of the Apes started out as a simple novel with a great concept. What if the humans and animals switch spots? The screenplay was loosely based off the novel with Michael Wilson and Rod Serling at the helm to bring the classic 1963 novel to the big screen. With a cast like Charlton Heston, James Whitmore, James Daly, and Linda Harrison, as well as Franklin J. Schaefer at the helm to direct, nobody expected how big this movie was about to get. The movie sparked four sequels from 1970 to 1973, remade in 2001 by Tim Burton, also turned into a TV series, comic books, and was rebooted in 2011, with the most recent this year. Not to mention the massive fan base has won Planet of the Apes numerous awards and nominations. The movie is about a team of astronauts that are in a deep hibernation when all of a sudden the ship crashes into a lake. As the astronauts gather themselves, they manage to get ashore, and they perform a soil test and reveal that the soil is incapable of sustaining life. Further into the movie, an oasis is found where the surviving astronauts get a first glimpse of something not quite human messing with their belongings. It's later revealed that the chimps, apes, and gorilla are running the planet, making humans their pets and experiments. Same concept as the book, has romance and action as well. The movie turns into a battle of the humans and apes, who will prevail.
Thanks. And John, in our lights, camera, and action sequence, why don't you start the discussion on how you found the film?
Sure. I hadn't seen this movie since I was about maybe 9 or 10 years old. And when I was rewatching it recently, there are a few things that came to mind. The first thought I had was, I didn't remember, probably because it was edited out during a daytime network ratings viewing purposes, the scene where Charlton Heston lurches himself bare bum and all through the air, diving into the pond with his juvial comrades. That scene was pretty provocative and also controversial for when this film was made, which was during the McCarthy era. So just a little side note for those of you who are unfamiliar with Hollywood trials that took place between 1947 and 56, it's an extremely interesting and detrimental era which inspired blacklisted writers and actors and producers and directors to work together to cultivate movies like Planet of the Apes. In order to send not only a message to the audience, but also to the industry that wished to silence and constrain artists' freedom of speech and expression by saying, basically, we are going to do this anyways, and we are going to tell our stories. So, but I digress. Another thought that occurred to me was how much my mind as a young adolescent somehow lumped this story into this caveman-esque style of the late 1970s and early 80s television, which for me was like the Flintstones and Land of the Lost, which made me receive this theme as sort of a comedic tone instead of seeing the themes in a much different, more surreal form. Speaking of which, so let's look at some of the themes that resonate from this film. One of the first scenes we have is Taylor Charlton Heston, who through a log entry is conveying the astronaut's journey from the Earth to seek a better, more progressive world than the one that they leave behind, which is, he alludes to this broken world is due to the follies of man. So this opens up a theme of man's claim or right of ownership of all life, and the costs or the juxtaposition of that when the shoe is on the other foot, i.e. the apes' control. This is threaded throughout the movie, which results obviously in a very shocking ending to the movie, which we probably should have said this earlier, spoiler alert. There's a lot of spoilers in what we're trying to explore. So please read and watch these movies. So
that's a good idea.
Would you like to add to that theme or discuss another theme that you might have found along the way as well?
I found with Planet of the Apes, the movie. I mean, it's one of my favorites anyway. And every time I watch it, I gain more and more. But I think with the film, I mean, it really is, it does deal with a lot of sociological issues of the time that, I mean, well, obviously we're, without going into too much politics here, or we're actually suffering from today. I mean, the whole society thing with, you know, the you know, the riots going on and stuff like this. And when Charlton Heston's leaving Earth, you know, he's saying there's got to be something better than man. And the whole issue with Planet of the Apes, I find, was, you know, man kills man, but ape doesn't kill ape. And Charlton Heston looking for a better life because Earth, you know, is on the brink of destruction, which is what we seem to be, you know, seems to be a general theme in this, in 1968. There's a lot, you know, when in the 1950s, what you had is you had all the atomic war and nuclear wars. And then in the 60s, you had the Vietnam War, of course, started. You had the race riots going on at that time.
The Sino-Indian War between China and India, too, was going on during that time.
Yeah. And there was a lot of conflict going on at that time. And then at that time, you know, when Planet of the Apes came out, you know, you do have the people working on it were, most of them were involved in the McCarthy era, as you stated before. And a lot of them fought in World War II at the same time. And they saw a lot of atrocities at that time, you know, whether it was Michael Wilson or, you know, Rod Serling through the Twilight Zone. We knew how he felt about man. Most of the similar themes that you find in Planet of the Apes are found in the Twilight Zone.
Yeah.
But I think that, you know, I find with Planet of the Apes, it's a film that shouldn't work, but works on so many levels. It's kind of a odd mixture.
Yeah, I looked at like science versus religion, you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, you know, and that kind of resonates throughout that movie where, especially when you think about communication in the movie, it's very different because communication is the same language. It's not different like from the book in the sense where it's, they understand, they just don't want to listen to them. And it's about, you know, being able to contain, suppress communication that's coming from Charlton Heston's character.
One of the biggest things for me is that the depth, kind of the height of the characters as well. Because Charlton Heston is, I mean, he wasn't Moses for nothing. I mean, he has that kind of screen presence with things. And he kind of overplays a lot of things. And especially...
Overplay? I don't know. What do you mean by that?
You damn dirty ape!
But you can tell that he's more angry. He's angry at being in the situation that he's in. Because he thought that he was going to go and become something... That surprise, you're a slave instead of mastering a new race on a new planet. Because Stewart, poor Stewart, who melted down the ship,
Stewart.
The only woman who was involved.
Page one or two, she made it. Yeah.
You might as well have a red shirt, too. I mean, but she was supposed to have been the breeding companion for the new race, and that didn't work out. So, you know, his whole idea of what they were supposed to do on the new planet kind of just faded into the sunset whenever they crash landed.
Yeah.
I mean, not to be a bit controversial, but what would have happened if, you know, that they were the only three guys on Earth? I mean, what were they going to do? I mean, would they just have to copulate with each other and just hope that, I mean, I don't, I mean, as, you know, once Stuart died and then they were like walking around, I mean, it's kind of hard to figure out what their plan was.
Well,
I mean,
it's also interesting because there was in the book, it was sort of, there was life everywhere. In this, it was very like a barren land. Like there was nothing.
Yeah.
Well, surviving, I guess, because they were worried about food. So we have to survive. But yeah, like you said, but why?
Yeah. Well, supposedly the forbidden zone, right? Where they landed, that was where the bomb blew up and you weren't supposed to go in the forbidden zone, but that's where they came from to go to see the apes. And, you know, that's where they went back to was the forbidden zone. So it was forbidden because it was probably radioactive and you couldn't grow anything there. So that was, to me, that was a better way of explaining things from a story perspective than that you couldn't go there because of what happened.
I think it was also the forbidden zone because of the fact that Dr. Zauis kind of nods to that is there's information there that is going to sort of discredit what these sacred scrolls have sort of been written for the word of the ape, you know, and it's the history that's there that was more dangerous than anything toxic. You know, it's a different type of toxicity, right? It's the knowledge is toxic if you know what it is and what it can do.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, what I think, where the film really excels is that whole slow buildup in the beginning. You know, you have, you know, Charlton Heston with his classic opening dialogue, and then you have the opening credits, then you have the crash sequence. And then as they're walking through, you get, you know, they're like, you know, they're having their bits of conversation, they're developing character there. But that whole long track, I mean, it seems to take forever. And the way that they filmed it, I mean, you don't know if it's, you know, are they traveling for days? Are they traveling for weeks? Are they one day? And it, yeah. They've done a really good job, and the whole desolate of the land, and it's so beautifully filmed. And, you know, and, you know, and then when they finally, you know, and then the build up, and then they finally do get there, and they do see the humans, the mad humans, who are smart enough to wear loincloths, which is important to notice.
Yeah. Yeah, because it's buck very different. They're buck naked all the time. Yeah, we just don't see them dangling, like flinging around there.
So for a race that apparently has no intelligence, they do know how to make some kind of clothing to cover themselves up. So that's quite impressive. But, and then you have the big reveal, you know, sort of thing. And I have to sit there and say that whole sequence up to that point is just fantastic filmmaking. You know, it's just, it just builds and builds, and you kind of watch it, and I have to sit there and say, as many times as I've seen it, and I do go through a whole Planet of the Apes theme thing every 3 to 4 years, where I'll watch one right straight through to the, you know, from the first movie all the way up to the current reincarnations of it. And when I watch the first one, every time, you know, and it's like, yeah. You know, and the gorilla is like, and you just go, your mouth just drops open.
I mean, it's also, that's when you, because the movie is the Planet of the Apes, so you're kind of like, you get the humans and you get the other humans, and you're like, well, what the hell, where are the apes? And then when they come, it's like, bam, they're right here, here they come. You know,
and I also think that, you know, and it does have the reflection of how they just handle the whole apes things, the way that they interact with each other, you know, after the hunt especially, where you have, you know, the gorillas posing with the dead carcasses of the humans. And, you know, and I mean, you know, it's basically, I mean, well, you know, when Clarence the lion got killed by that dentist, I mean, it was pretty much the same pose. I mean, it's like, yeah. You know, where, you know, when Facebook went up in flames, it's like, you know, and, you know, that's what hunters do. They have their pictures taken with the dead. And there's this, and the whole thing is like, you're kind of watching it, and the juxtaposition of everything, you just sit there with your mouth fully open, and you're just totally enthralled with the whole situation.
Yeah, and I also wondered, like, in that time watching it, how jaunting that was, because I think now we're a little jaded, right? Like, I think as we've watched other movies, science fiction movies or horror movies for that matter, the more you watch something, the more you're just kind of like, oh, really? That's it? You know, like, but for that time, that had to be very jaunting for people, and, like, maybe awakening for some people who were hunters, you know, like, you know, you're hunting, oh dear, like, how does it feel, you know? Like, humans are getting hunted, and now look at that, what it looks like on the other end, you know.
But supposedly humans didn't feel anything, that they'd lost their humanity, they didn't.
Yeah,
apes felt that they could do that because they were just, didn't have a soul. Yeah. They were soulless creatures, and they didn't, it didn't matter what they thought or they felt.
Yeah.
So that was the difference, was that, you know, shoes on the other foot now, buddy.
Yeah.
You see how it feels. And that's basically, I think, the biggest theme of the whole, of the movie especially, is that look what you do to other things
as a human being. Again, do unto others as others would do unto you. And how does that, you know, that feel? And there's that, obviously, within most stories, there's that religious undertone of, you know, a call to a higher power, and what does this mean? And it was, I guess, more predominant in the book in this sense from these Taylor, Blue Eyes, whatever you want to call him.
Bright Eyes.
Of the fact that Bright Eyes here, Blue Eyes.
Turn around.
Blue, bright, whatever.
Turn around.
It's that sort of religious undertone of, you know, seeking a higher power and having a soul, and what does a soul mean, and, you know.
I think the best
part for me is how well that they hid the wangs in the first part, because it was like, there's a leaf right there, there's a rock,
I have to say that.
Go turn over in the water right now. Okay.
That scene, I was just like, wow, okay. I did not remember that. And again, I think it's because it was on afternoon television. They just cut that whole scene out, you know, but it was, wow, okay. And that's pretty shocking. And you think like Barbarella and stuff like that. Obviously, they did stuff more with women. With men, that was like a huge.
But, but in Barbarella, I mean, at the same time, you never did see, you know, Jane Fonda's backside.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, she's very clever. I mean, she's very cleverly covered up. I mean, you see, these guys are actually skinny dipping. I mean, when they're swimming in the water, they are actually skinny dipping.
They're totally frolicking. And then there's that scene again. There's a scene where, you know, obviously they look at the footprint in the sand or in the water, and they're like, "Hey, Taylor, come on over, look." Yeah. And it's just very homoerotic. I mean, it's a funny scene. You know, the two guys get down. Yeah, let's. What is this? And he's like just standing there with his hands on his head. Like, what are you looking at, guys?
It's a pretty big step there. Where the guy looks up. Where he comes over to the side and looks up, like right between the guy's legs.
Yeah. And it's just sort of like, okay, yeah, sure, you know.
Mouth gaped open, what? but I mean, there's like other bits in it as well. It's kind of like, you know, but what Josh was saying about, the intelligent foliage that was able to cover up certain things. It just, I mean, looking at it now, it's almost like, you know, I mean, Austin Powers probably did the perfect piss take of that, you know, where it's like, you know, with the melons in front of her and sort of thing. But yeah, I mean, I do, you know, that does bring us to Nova, who, like Raquel Welch, was able to sit there and wear a, you know, fully supportive bullet bra at the same time that she's wearing her.
with her perfectly coiffed hair, I should
precisely. I mean, I don't know what those mad humans were doing, but I mean, she was well conditioned and she always had a good manicure and pedicure, which I think is very impressive that when you're prehistoric and you cannot talk and you're dumb and you're, you know, animalistic in every way, they're able to keep a good appearance.
Yeah, exactly. Bad news for all, but good for her man. I mean,
bad news for you blondes.
Hey!
Well, you know, look what happened. Look what happened to Stuart. I mean, Stuart didn't last long. Just
saying. Redheads, blondes, brunettes, or brunettes, the bang man, dyed black hair. I think they got those from the Indians that they scalped on the other set. The Indian scalps that they wore. They just go, "Hey, can you bring these over here and we'll put them on these people? They can run around."
I think it's interesting too that like Dr. Zauis had a very much bigger character in this story because he was, I guess you can say he kind of was the villain, but not really. I think it's debatable. I personally feel that the villain is, it kind of switches back and forth to me. I personally think Taylor's a little bit of a villain because I think Taylor is overconfident and cocky and but Dr. Zauis is just trying to do right by his people and trying to protect them and, you know, is ambiguous that in that role.
Well, Charlton Heston's Taylor role is, I mean, he's very confrontational. I mean, you know, when he's with Dodge and the other astronaut, sorry, I cannot remember his name, but
it is, what's his name? Landon.
Yeah. So he's in Landon and Dodge, and I mean, he just rides Landon all the way. And
I know.
I mean, and not in a sexual sense, but in a verbal sense.
there was that writing scene. Flashy.
I mean, I have to sit there and say that Landon was, you know, he had that Sean Connery thing going for him, so who knows what would happen there.
I actually thought that was Sean Connery, by the way, because I was like, wait, I don't remember Sean Connery was in this, and, and then I realized it was, what was his name? It's Robert Gunner. I didn't know that was Robert Gunner. Yeah.
And what has Robert Gunner done in the past?
I don't know. What has he done in the past?
I have no idea. I mean, it's been like...
Sorry, folks. We will get back to you. If you want more information on Robert Gunner, we'll make sure we'll give you...
But I know that, you know, but I mean, he's so bitter all the way through, really.
Yeah.
And, you know, Is that it is that thing of be careful what you wish for that you will get, because I mean, let's be honest. I mean, in the beginning he says, is there a world better than man, all this other stuff, and then he lands and then he gets there, and like, to be honest, he has found, he's found a civilization that is better than man. He did get what he asked for. He got what he wished.
He sort of took on the traits of Professor Anantel, because Anantel was very bitter. Like, he was like, oh, you know, he said, I think, that line, which was that whole, oh, well, it's a man's fault that we, you know, our world's the way it is. We're going to find a better place, you know?
Yeah. And, I mean, I think it's quite wise to give him that personality, because, you know, what I also find interesting is, outside of a couple scenes, I mean, everything's done through Taylor's eyes anyway. It opens up with Taylor's views. You follow Taylor all the way straight through. And then you have a couple scenes where he's not in, where you actually get Cornelius and Zira's little scene there. I think,
which they are talking about him. So he is, I guess, if you think about it that way, he is technically in that scene.
And then you get Dr. Zauis on his own, viewing the after work of what Taylor's done in the cage afterwards. But it's mainly everything's told from Taylor's point of view, really. And surprisingly, for having such a bitter character all the way through it, he keeps your focus. You know, not any point where you're just like, you know, I never felt at any time, because normally it's like if you spend like a whole movie with someone that bitchy, you just want to go through the screen and slap them after a while.
Yeah.
But you never actually get that from him, which I have to sit there and say that the script writing in this was very, very sharp and very, very one of the strongest things.
Yeah.
And I also
his not being able to communicate. That's like an easy way to ensue conflict, because you're literally, you just feel frustrated for that person, like, you know.
And, you know, and then you have that climactic scene where he does get his voice back. And he says that most famous, you know, one of the famous lines, get your hands off me, you dirty ape. And the thing, and the way it's filmed, it's like, you know, and at the same time, it's like when the apes are looking surprised. I mean, I think, you know, most of the audiences with their mouths dropped, like, oh my God, you know, it's like,
yeah,
sort of thing. And
I also think I love, like, you kind of see Dr. Zero's face, and she's just kind of like, ha, you know, she's laughing, kind of.
I mean, to me, this whole character is Zira.
Yeah.
I mean, Zira is like my ultimate favorite. You know?
She's, and, like you said, the strongest female, the ultra feminist in this movie.
Well, she's really the only one that's willing to change. Mm-hmm. You know, she's one willing to accept someone for what they are. Because she looks at him and says, she doesn't see a animal, she sees a person, because I mean, like a lot of people, like humans that work with animals, say, you know, someone that works with apes and teaches them how to do sign language, they know a lot more about them than we do, and so they will ascribe more humanity to them than we would, because they're used to dealing with them all the time. And that's probably why she chose that job anyway, was because she felt that toward humans, she felt empathy and she felt a compassion toward them in the beginning. And then when she could find one that gave it back to her, then it was a plus. You know, someone that she all this time was hoping to find. And then when she finally finds it, she's like, wow, this is amazing that this can happen. Unfortunately, it doesn't turn out too well in the end for her, because, you know, basically they're in bad place because they're sticking up for him. Her and Cornelius both get in a bad place.
But she still is, she has not only compassion for humans, she has compassion for her fellow ape. Because even when Dr. Zauis is strung up by Taylor, she's like, don't do that to him. Like, it's degrading. And I was degraded by you. And it is just a level, I think she's just very compassionate being. So regardless of what happens to her, you kind of think, you know, she's going to be okay, because she has that level of compassion, because we see what happens when people act out of anger and what the results of that are, you know, and you're not going to win. But with compassion, there's anything that's possible.
And did you get the idea that they were surprised of how aggressive when they're at the cave, when he takes, when everyone goes to the cave and then Dr. Zaius and the other apes show up, he's very aggressive and he has the gun and he tries to shoot them down. It seemed to me like she was very surprised and shocked that he would react in that way, that he would become that mean, you know, almost like a biting dog. She was surprised that her friend was willing to kill someone like that.
I also find with Zira as well, the role or her job title is animal psychiatrist.
Yeah, that's true.
Which is quite an interesting take. I mean, maybe we have animal psychiatrists today. I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, they call them the cat whisperer and
the horse whisperer. But I thought that
Jackson.
I think what really makes this film work, and I have to say that normally this doesn't work, but because they lack the budget. Because they were, you know, Rod Serling's original script, as you know, had all the technology in it and everything that's more based on the book. Yeah. And because they didn't have the money for that, and, you know, Michael Wilson said, no, we need to scale this, you know, we need to scale this back. So they brought Michael Wilson in to scale everything back.
To un-industrialize.
Industrialize it. Same thing with the Ape City, was supposed to be a lot bigger, so they had to shorten that, and then it had a lot more sequences and a lot more scenes, and but they were everything, you know, brought it in closer. And I have to sit there and say, I think that's what keeps the film timeless to this day, because I'm sure that, you know, if there was a lot of, you know, if they didn't weren't able to do that, there would have been a lot of bad blue screen that we looked at today, like same way that we look at some of the things of Mary Poppins or, you know, Fantastic
CGI.
Voyage.
CGI.
Well. It's
like not seeing the shark in Jaws still almost the middle of the movie.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting because
where you can have your imagination instead.
I read something about they filmed a lot of it in Arizona, and it was like in the desert area where it was like 100-something degrees. So you kind of you feel that actually in the movie. It's not like a back lot where you're just kind of like, oh, we're gonna go have lunch over here at the commissary. We'll be right back, you know. And it's like you see that they just look like they're suffering, you know. But like you said, it makes it timeless. It makes it very something you feel like it just resonates.
And just having people in masks, they've got really good actors to come in and play these parts. I mean every single chimpanzee that has a speaking role is a very good. I mean, they deliver it with so much honesty and belief.
I also read this today too, which is like little trivia thing. So Charlton Heston didn't realize the actress that plays Zira who she was, and so. For I forget how many days she was in the makeup. It was like, I think it was like 20 days later when he saw her at a dinner, she was like, oh, hey, Charles. And he's like, who are you? And she's like, hello, we just were working together. And she confronted him, was basically like, I'm Zira. And he's like, wait, what? And he kind of was shocked because she'd done such a great job exuding this character with this makeup that he didn't even realize it was her.
Well, Kim Hunter, previous to this, she was in A Streetcar Named Desire with Marlon Brando.
Yeah.
You know, and she was up for an Oscar. And then, of course, the McCarthy era happened, and she wasn't able to work in films ever again up until this movie where they brought her back out.
Just kind of a side note on that. Have you guys seen that movie Trumbo?
Yeah, it's actually really good.
That's a great movie if anybody wants to learn about that era in the movies. Alton Trumbo was right in the middle of all of that, and he wrote two Academy Award-winning scripts that he didn't get credit for. He gave them to someone else to put their name on because he couldn't use them. So if you don't know about that time, that Trumbo is a great movie. Well, Bryan Cranston, again, of course.
Yeah. It's crazy because there are now a lot of directors back then who didn't get credit. It's their families are getting credit for these directors who were just sort of pushed out, blacklisted, considered communists. So yeah, it is a great movie. I loved it.
Yeah, that's what they're saying. But I mean, it does feed through in the film sort of thing. I mean, Planet of the Apes, there's a lot of that feeling through the film sort of thing where, you know, the oppression. I mean, and the apes do have a perfect society, but there's a lot of oppression going on there. Information is very, very well hidden from the populace. Only a few, very few are able to know the truth, and the rest of it, you know.
I was going to say, I noticed in the screenplay that they cut a lot of that dialogue out, which at the end of the movie, Dr. Zauis actually explains everything, and they cut that out of the screenplay for some reason. I mean, they cut it out of the movie from the screenplay because I think it was just maybe too much exposition. They wanted you to kind of feel that Dr. Zauis knows more and he's just not telling people. And again, it frustrates you more because you want to be like, why? Wait, I want to know why. And he kind of saves that for himself. And from a viewing point, it makes sense that they cut that out because it is that I know something you don't, and I'm not going to tell you, you know, and it leads to that frustration. Or they could have also saved it for the next movie too. So
I think that's a big, I mean, writing the way it used to be and the way it is now it seems like everyone has to tell you exactly everything to think and to feel at every turn.
And exposition, before, exposition, exposition. Right.
Before it was like, well, you figure it out. You know, this is for you. You know, that's like the idea of having an English class and saying, well, did the author feel this or that? But if it was honestly, and you talk to the author, a lot of times they didn't feel anything. It was just the story. Yeah. And it wasn't a big deal. But, you know, when you're writing, a lot of times things happen in your subconscious and you put it on the page and not really thinking or knowing about it in the front of your mind, and it just is there. So I think that's, like you were saying, that's way better that they didn't put that in there so you could just take the story for yourself.
Yeah. And you kind of voted left with, you're left with all the characters, because that's a very pivotal moment where they all are together hashing out this situation. And it is one of these things where, you know, one goes one direction, another goes another direction, and it sort of leaves you with what's next, you know?
I also find that, you know, the whole, you know, what happens to the other characters between Landon and Dodge, Dodge being put into a museum, because, which I found a bit bizarre, not that they put him in a museum, but the simple fact that, you know, once the big reveal comes out, which I'm sure everyone knows what the big reveal is, but that Landon's the only black person left on the face of the earth, it seems, which I found that a bit strange.
He's in a museum.
Yeah. But, you know, it's kind of addressed in the sequels, which, you know, we can cover a bit more in the, when we compare the book to the screen. But yeah, I found that a quite an odd thing, really. And I also found that, you know, once you got Nova, once they separate Nova from everyone else, besides the monkeys, like, you know, the humans reaching out to the cage begging for food, you don't really get a lot more of the humans. And you get one child, which is quite interesting. You get the one child who's carried on the gorilla's back, so you're not quite sure what happens to him. He gets thrown into the wagon. You know? But you don't see the children at all anymore, so I don't know if they exterminate them or they put them in somewhere else. So you're never quite sure what happens.
You can also think, I mean, you can sort of allude to maybe that they fix them like they would fix animals, and you're kind of like, because to control populace, you want to make sure there's not too many of the herd, right? So you want to kind of like, let's go neuter them and then we'll put them back out or whatever, you know?
Well, they do mention in the sequels, basically, is that when they go out to kill the humans, it is to help save their crops and is to population control. Like if there's too many foxes or too many rabbits that we do today, it was a way of population control. And it was a way for the gorillas to get rid of their frustration because they were kind of highly... they had pretty much, you know, a very high drive sort of thing where they basically had a lot of energy, and it was a way for them to get rid of their energy because the gorillas were for war, and because they were a peaceful society, there was no war for them to go to.
Yeah.
Which later on in the other films, you know, that is explored a bit more with the gorillas. But Zira does mention it about, you know, the gorillas just like, you know, about the gorillas being quite thick-headed, not as smart as the chimpanzees or the orangutan. They're just there for this reason.
Yeah.
And then, you can kind of see through her the tension that's there, because I think Cornelius doesn't want to rock the boat. So he just kind of, yes, sir, no, sir, yes, sir. Whereas Zira, like you said, is like, she's ultra feminist. She's like, I don't believe in this. No, you know, and she speaks her mind and says what she wants to say and do what she wants to do. And she's very logical and smart, smart enough to know that, you know, it can get her into trouble, but she doesn't care. Like, she's going to still do it and say it because it needs to be said.
Well, she's actually, I think, you know, I've read and I've actually did a blog about this, but she's actually the true feminist of any person in science fiction. Zira, you can say, is actually the 100% feminist. She's able to have a career. She's able to speak her mind. She's able to have a relationship. And later on, she's able to have a child. And she's able to have it all. And there's nothing that she has to give up to get what she wants. And normally in feminists, especially, you know, either it's the modern day feminists portrayed in, you know, modern fiction today, or whether you're looking at the feminists in earlier films, they always had to give something up. They either had to give up the man, they had to give up having being a mother, or
the career,
or they have to give up their career, but there's no way they could have it all. And I had to sit there and say, with Rod Serling and Michael Wilson's script, they actually found someone who could actually have it all without giving up anything, but not having to make any excuses for it either. She doesn't have to make any excuses for herself. This is who she is. This is it. And I'd say that, you know, especially, you know, 1968, and you look at what's being done now, you don't really get that in anything since then. She's, you know, I can't think of any, you know, ultra feminist character that you actually get anything that they haven't had to give something up.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
Yeah. I think also that's quite interesting is that I was doing some research on Planet of the Apes, and there are some criticisms against Planet of the Apes where they're talking about it being the social class of the apes, saying that the orangutans are at the top and because they're pale skin. And then you have the chimpanzees, which they're in the middle, and then the gorillas, which is the black race, and they're at the bottom.
Interesting.
And then what you have is you have the middle section, which is the chimpanzees, and they're unhappy with the, you know, too much at the top or too much at the bottom. They think everyone should be in the middle. Now, I don't know. I mean, these are a lot of film historians that are actually look at this, and I can see it to a certain degree, but another degree, you can pretty much feed what you want into it, you know.
To me, those are the characteristics of the species here on Earth.
Precisely. That's how I would look at it.
Gorillas are big and strong, and they can be aggressive with intruders, especially. Chimpanzees are a little more, well, when they're not eating monkeys, they're a little more, they look a little more like they're thinking about things. They use tools.
That,
you know, they're more mechanically minded. Orangutans look like they're thinking. Yeah. You know, they have those big faces, and they look like they're, you know, really thinking about something. They're really not, but that's what they look.
Well, you don't know. See, that's a perception. Until one of them draws a geometric shape, and then you're screwed.
I mean, the thing is, to be honest, orangutans in scientific institutions can sign language, and you can sign language with them, and they will sign language back. They're not aping you. But they are. They can communicate. They actually talk to senses.
It's like mimicking.
Hello to the orangutan. To the MB orangutan at this point. Say a hello to the Sumatra? Where the orangutan lives.
Now they use pictographs, so now it's went beyond even sign language where they can actually use pictographs to have a conversation.
Yeah, I was talking about the MB our agency adopted a orangutan, right,
in the Congo? Nice.
And because we just got an update on her about that she was doing better, was more healthy, but they
We've adopted, we got two orangutans. We got Jojo and we got Doris that we saved. Aww. They're in Borneo. So we get updates on them every 6 months. So
I thought I'd give them a hello.
Is one of them named Sirius at all by chance? I'm just kidding.
But, But yeah, but then, you know, chimpanzees are nothing. Up until chimpanzees, before they hit puberty, they're very learnable. Unfortunately, once they hit puberty, they become aggressive and quite mean. So, you know, like Bubbles, Michael Jackson's Bubbles had to be, you know.
Well, that's, given that kind of goes back to aggressive. That goes back to you talking about the gorillas having to, it's like a natural instinct kicks in and they need to have that aggression vent before they take it out on like an ape. So they have to use that instinct to be able to release that energy or that anger.
I mean, I'm pretty sure when Rod Serling and Michael Wilson later on wrote the script, I don't think that they were actually thinking about, you know, the human race when they came up with the hierarchy of the apes community. Because to be honest, I mean, both of their history is all about equal rights and fighting for, you know, human equal rights across all religions, all ethnicities and stuff like this. And I don't think that's what they meant when they were doing that. I'm sure they meant, as Joshua was saying, it was more about the tenacity of the apes as they are today. You know, as I said before, the gorillas being aggressive, chimpanzees being very intelligent, which is, you know, chimpanzees are always known as being very intelligent. Whenever you see them in circuses or you see them on TV, they always have, you know, they're almost human-like. And then the orangutans, of course, you know, they actually communicate there. I mean, they've been known for doing sign language and they use them in science institutions. So I'm sure it was set up in that kind of way then. But, than, you know, what they're saying. I think that, you know, but I think that the Planet of the Apes itself, it does deal with a lot of issues and stuff like this, and they do address things in a very intelligent way, so.
Yeah, very much so.
Well, did we want to start the Critics' Choice section then?
Yeah, let's start the Critics' Choice. That's just where we're going to discuss, where we're going to compare the book to the screen.
So different.
Yeah, really so different.
And Joshua is going to lead us up on that.
The biggest issue that I saw was that basically the screenwriters, in my opinion, were much better writers than the novelist was, because they used a lot more. When a writer is training, you get basically, you know, you have first, second, third act, denouement, come down to the end and big reveal, you know, then, you know, to the end. In the book, he didn't really have that, per se. He kind of rambled around a lot and kind of hemmed and hawed through places and then got back to what he was supposed to be and then kind of just blew it at the end, as far as I'm concerned. It is kind of just spent his powder in one kind of paragraph. So that, to me, that was the biggest thing.
I think that, I mean, it's quite interesting because I'm a fan of the series, and there are elements in the book that do get used later on in the other films. You know, instead of Nova and Taylor having a baby, what you do get is and escape from the Planet of the Apes. Cornelius and Zira have a baby, and they all get murdered on Earth, except for the baby who becomes Caesar, who starts...
Oh, okay.
The rebellion.
The rebellion later on.
It's like a Terminator thing.
Yeah, kind of thing. They did go back in time sort of thing, which is interesting to see. Nothing's better than Zira in 1970s on pantsuits.
Yeah. Velvet. The work of the pantsuits.
Working it.
And, you know, they did do that. They also, you know, they also went into more of the Forbidden Zone and escape the battle side of it. About, you know, the way that the whole, you know, situations that was explained in the book is also looked at again in the, you know, in the other films as well, the way that was set up. And the, you know, another thing in the book where they become quite modernized and stuff like this is what's happening with the new set of films, Dawn, Rise, and War. These apes are going to be more technically advanced.
Right.
So it's funny how they take in one book and they have all these different elements, but they're able to carry those elements forward, even though they weren't able to carry it forward in the original film.
Yeah.
It's also, I think it's very interesting that, you know, they made a very conscious decision to deviate really far away from the original written story to then the movie. And I think you Keith, you had mentioned too, saying that it was a cost, obviously, issue for the studios to be able to invest the dollars in bringing those elements into the story. But like, even the very end is like extremely different from, you know, them going back to Earth and Earth being invaded by apes versus, you know, Taylor getting on the horse with Nova and riding off, and they realize that it is Earth. So that's two very contrasting difference, where one is there is another planet that exists with apes that is maybe somehow could have populate or could have conquered Earth, or it's just a separate world, and then they come back to an Earth that is now evolved from, you know, apes have now taken over. So it's interesting that they made that choice, because you then have to kind of stick with it. And then, like you said, as the movies went along, they brought in elements to bring in from the book and continue to try to tell that story in a very different way, you know?
There's, I also quite liked in the film to book sort of thing is the way that, you know, some of the issues that are mentioned in the book, you know, the social issues are, they do bring those forward in the original movie, which is quite, but they do it in a quite a more interesting sort of way, you know.
Like the construct of the sort of a society where each one of them, their positioning, is that what you mean?
Or yeah, the positioning of them, the whole thing about, you know, Taylor, I mean, Taylor is actually a lot more attractive than the Ulysses character is. But all the same traits of Ulysses outside of him, you know, entering ape society and, you know, whatever suit he's wearing. You know, but he's able to, the way that they did the whole thing, I mean, it's pretty much in there outside, you know, the sex mating dance, the Nova. But, yeah. You know, but that whole big, all that stuff is still in the movie, but they've done it in a way that made it a bit more, I don't know, for some reason it works better in the film than it does in
I think what it is that in the book, the Ulysses characters was more passive.
Yeah,
he
absolutely.
He was riding it out. He was riding the storm out. He wasn't going to rock the boat. He was going to go along with it. Charlton Heston wasn't going along with nothing. He was going to fight him, and he was going to do what he was going to do. And then at the very end, too, that liberty of, I'm on the horse with my babe on the back, and I'm heading that way, you know, that we're going to do something here and leave these people, these apes behind, and start our own deal here. And then he realizes that, well, number one, that he's somewhere on the Pacific coast instead of in New York City, but that's here nor there. But that he's back in his home, and that the way that he felt about the apes, that aggression that he had toward them, that's why they did it, because that was him. You know, at the very end, he was like, he was angry at them for being like him. You know,
well, that aggression. I think he was also mad. He was mad that man fucked it up. Like, he's mad, like, you did it. You gone and did it. You know, like, oh, you know.
He saw that in himself, though. He saw that anger that humans have and that aggression, because he was willing to shoot down all of those apes. He was willing to kill them all if he had to. And that anger in him, and I think it was an angry character from start to finish. You know, that's what the huge difference was. The main character was very much more aggressive.
Well, I also think because, again, you look at the written piece, like the novel, in the sense that the time frame is long. Like, it has to be, like, at one point you point out that Nova has a baby, that's 9 months. But before that, the build up and the integration into society, all that, so you have to think this has to be at least almost like 2 years, maybe, I don't know. Whereas a movie, it's so fast from the very start, from when they crash to getting, we need to get food, so then they're searching for food, and then we need to get our clothes are getting taken, and now it's, everything is just moving at such a fast pace. By the end of the film, it could be a couple of weeks, maybe, it could be, we just don't know, versus the film, there has to be almost a passivity to Ulysses, because, again, he's a journalist, He's there to explore and figure out what the society is, and then he gets to state. Yeah, so exactly. So he gets to also state his. I call this chapter the chapter where he is getting to. I think it's 34, where he gets to. Oh no, I call it. It's chapter 25. Lip sync for your life. Because he gets to stand up there and tell everyone, hey, my fellow apes, in their language, look, this is who I am. Hear me now. And he goes into this whole, you know, dialogue, and he wins, right? Versus the film, he doesn't win. It's shut up, sit down. You two are scientists. You're a treason. Take them away. You know, we're going to lobotomize you. Castrate you. You're done. Out. So he literally, Ulysses got to actually lip sync for his life, and he won. He won his argument, and he got to go in society and live that life. And it wasn't until he questioned the science, when he started questioning the science and the religion, is when he became a threat, and they wanted to deal with him, you know.
I also think, the funny thing about, I think where the film works really, really well, where it's the book kind of lacks a little bit, is that setting everything on Earth to begin with was the way it really worked. I mean, and to be honest, when Taylor finally realizes he's on Earth, he doesn't realize it to the last frame of that movie. I mean, he sees the baby. He still doesn't put it together. It's only when he sees the Statue of Liberty that he puts it together. I mean, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and there's also that aerial view when they're obviously crashing that you know, in the book, they give this slow descent. You know, it is a foreign planet, but I'm saying in the movie, you get to see this aerial view and you're not noticing some sort of land mass, you know, what it looks like. And you don't realize, oh, that looks kind of like the United States, where you're from. Again, because they're all American boys, right?
Yeah.
The three of these guys are all American boys. You know, it'd be one thing if they did land in France, because they're not familiar with that land mass. But
it's I have to sit there and say that on defense of the film, though, because when they come upon the Statue of Liberty, I mean, as you know, where it is in New York City, but that's all one land mass. There's no, you know, there's no Hudson River running through anything or anything like that.
That's true. Yeah.
And so, you know, they do land in they don't land in the ocean, do they? Like, they land in like
some kind of Lake Havasu.
Like some pond.
Pond or a lake.
That's Lake Havasu that they crashed in.
Which again, it's kind of funny that they just hop into the water. You know, yeah. I think they
it's not lava or whatever.
By the way, they in the screenplay they do write like test the water, and I was like, oh well, at least you had it there, but you didn't have it in the movie. Everyone just jumped ship. There was like, just jump in, go.
Well, no, there's a part where when the water's pouring in, and then he goes, oh, if you check it, they do go, oh, I've checked the atmosphere, we're fine, and because then they go, well, pop the hatch.
Yeah, but atmosphere is atmosphere. Water is something completely different. And even then, they jump into the pond nude. Are you not afraid of some like swimming creatures is going to nibble you?
Yeah.
No. It's like, let's jump in, boys. Let's frolic.
Or there's even Jardia. If you got a Jardia.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, overall, I think the film is actually a bit more successful than the book. By my own personal view.
Well, you can really see Rod Serling's stamp on the movie. Yeah. Because there's a lot of things, you know, especially the Twilight Zone episodes, the ones that were about nuclear war, you know, that whole idea of nuclear war and how it was inevitable, you really see his stamp on it. And then at the very end, I always think that Rod Serling is basically the O. Henry of the 60s and 70s, yeah. Because, you know, he had that same, you know, get it to the end and pop one on, you know, yeah. that surprise thing, you know. And he really does a great job of that, though, at having that to be the ending thing. It's like, you know, close up, there it is.
I also love that Zayas gets to be you know, do you really want to open that Pandora's box? Because I don't think you should, you know, just be careful what you do, you know, and I like that he, again, it's like he, to me, he's not the villain because he gives warning. Don't do it. Just don't do it.
And you won't like what you'll find out there, Taylor.
You won't like what you find. And even in a very sadistic way, he's like, you know, you can come back and we'll put you in a cage because that's where you belong. And oh, screw you. I'm not going back in a cage. You know, I'm a human. I'm so much better than that. And you're like, not really.
Well, I have to sit there and say one of the most powerful speeches is there is when Roddy McDowell or Cornelius reads the sacred scroll at the end and you go, beware the beast called man. And you're like, he's saying this and you're like, and I have to sit there and say it myself. I think of that as like, God, you know, he is so right. I mean, you know, especially if you look at the world today and everything that they're saying, I mean, you know, man's been on earth for how many thousands of years and man has never learned a freaking lesson anywhere along the line.
Yeah.
Same mistakes, same problems that we had 20 years ago are still going on, 100 years ago, 200 years ago, you name it, and we're still as screwed up as we ever were. And you know,
this last week,
some zingers too. Zaius had some really interesting zingers. I was trying to find one that he said that I thought it's so interesting that because Taylor thinks he can just be like, you know, nasty to him and say something back, and the way Zaius responds, it's so like, yeah, you're just being like a basic hypocrite, basically. You know. Yeah.
Well, what you're saying, Josh?
Saying, that's exactly the point, though. Is you look at what happened last week, you had a chance of thermonuclear war on this planet last week with all that the thing that happened. You know, we thought, well, we're past that after the Cold War was over, you know, but all of the weapons are still there. You know, there's still a chance of doing that, even by accident, there's still a chance. So, and you don't really know how it happened, right? Just that it did. It might have been an accident. They might have finally, you know, gone to war and blown each other up. You don't really know that for sure. But just the fact that it did happen, you know, that was the.
Oh, so here's a line. Dr. Zaius, I know who I am. Who are you? How did this upside down civilization ever get started? Zaius, you may well call it upside down since you occupy its lowest level, and deservingly. It was just kind of like, please.
Well, I mean, but even you know, even that one-on-one where Zaius and Taylor have that scene at the end of the court scene,
in the room, right?
In the room, and Taylor goes, you've been against me ever since you met me. And he goes, you know, and then, you know, Zaius goes into his whole thing about what man has done. Yeah. And, I mean, I have to sit there and say that Taylor is kind of, you know, clouded by his own emotions because, you know, he should have came to the realization where he was because, you know, he's told this. He still doesn't pick up on it. I mean, you know, the movie starts with him having this whole thing about man, you know, are they still killing your brother, blah, da, 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 da. You know, then all this stuff happens. And then, you know, he's told this by Zaius, you know, I've known about you before you even came here, all this other stuff. And, you know, this is what man's done. And then, you know, they find the cave. They found the talking doll. And, you know, Taylor still hasn't twigged. I mean, but then again, us in the audience still haven't twigged either, so we're just as thick as Taylor at this point. And then, you know, and then Zaius tells what his does, and then, you know, Cornelius does his bit, and then he doesn't really realize it until he hits the Statue of Liberty, which you kind of think that, you know, all the clues are there, and, you know, but Taylor's still blinded by his own ambitions or his, you know, or his own megalomania, per se.
Yeah.
But I mean, when I saw Zaius like the first time, I thought, oh, you know, he's the evil one. But actually, it's Zaius that is probably one of the most intelligent at the same time. You know, he holds all the cards. He knows everything that's going on.
Well, it just goes back to the idea of the greater good, right?
Yeah.
You can have freedom, but if it's not for the greater good, is it really worth it? That's basically what he's there as kind of a check that we can't go past this point. Or else this will happen. This cycle will happen again. So we can't do that, and that's why That's why he makes a religion. That's why they made a religion, is to hold that in check. You can't do this. It's written that you shouldn't do that.
Well, Zaius is also the government as well. You got to remember that there's a lot of stuff the government's not cannot share with the public because they do not want the public to go racing around. It's a bit like when I was dealing with serial killers and murderers and stuff like this in my profession. I mean, there's a lot that goes on that you're not allowed to tell the public, because if you tell the public, they're going to be running all over the place like a bunch of ants, you know, and you know, screaming and
mass hysteria. Violence,
mass hysteria, and you have to be, you know, you have to keep people away from the mass hysteria.
The one thing that I find interesting too about the screenplay is how they write in the emotions of Dr. Zaius towards the end, and how he does feel bad. He has angst to where he says, like, seal the cave, and it says with angst. And then they're pissed that he's doing all this. And then, you know, the nephew is like, why must you, you know, Lucius is like, Dr. Zaius is inexcusable. Why must knowledge stand still? What about the future? And Zaius looks benevolently at Julius and says, I may have just saved it for you, meaning he let him go for that reason, because he's like, I can't hold back truth, but I can at least try to contain it, this little wildfire right now, by blowing this up so other people don't ask what this is and find it, but I'm giving it a chance, basically. So I think he wants it to exist. He wants the truth to exist, but he's more concerned about his community and making sure, you know, he can contain it, you know.
What I loved about that scene in particular is I love the conversation that Taylor has with Zira or Cornelius' nephew. I can't remember whose nephew he is. But, you know.
I think he's Zira's.
Yeah. And that conversation that he has, you know, about him being the younger generation, you know, and, you know, keep rebelling. And I thought that was.
Oh, yeah. He's nice, like, something touch about the wings, keeping your wings or something. He's like, what? And he's like, never mind. Just keep being young.
Yeah. And I thought that was very well done.
And it's also cute because he is so open-minded that it comes nothing to him. Like, it's sort of hearing him speak as a human to him. He's just like, oh, yeah, okay. But he's pissed that he's like, great, my family tells me what to do and a human tells me what to do. So everyone's telling me what to do now. You know, it's cute. You know, I like that.
Yeah. So that brings us up to the epilogue. So, Mandie, what are your final thoughts?
Pretty much, I mean, I wrote a little thing. I'll read it, I guess. Planet of the Apes has had a huge cultural influence that leaves a mark on most who dwell into the franchise. The original movie itself was responsible for pushing boundaries as well as making viewers and readers alike take a step back and think about how we as humans treat fellow man and animals. Planet of the Apes as a series influenced various films and television productions during the 1970s and 80s that used science fiction settings and characters to explore race relations, including Alienation, Ebony Mind, and V. With the newest movie to the franchise, War of the Planet of the Apes, still dominating box offices, it's safe to say that fans and new fans alike will keep the franchise alive for decades to come.
Nice. And what about you, Joshua? What are your final thoughts?
Personally, I wasn't all that enthralled with the book itself, but there's the idea that just a theme of something can last for that long. You know, that he wrote the book in the mid 60s, and now in the mid teens, they're still going with the idea. I mean, it wasn't a masterpiece in writing, but it was a very good idea. It made people think about things. And that, more than anything, is the reason that certain things become iconic, is because there's something that people want to try and understand, but you never really will, because you will not ever be able to get a 100% on it. You won't know. So that's why stories keep going, is because there's always a what if.
And what about yourself, John? What are your final thoughts?
My final thoughts is something that I kind of would say to our listeners, is that, you know, this is a book that I never read and I kind of wish I did. And
the movie, like I said, as a kid, it was from a different child's perspective. As an adult, it definitely carries a different tone and weight for me, especially during that time it was created. But definitely recommend that if you haven't read the book and you haven't seen the original, it's now more important than ever that we try to instill this in our listeners that it's always going back to the original, always going back to where it started, because we are in the day and age of everything old is new again. So as we see re-emerging television series and re-emerging remakes, and it's important to know where it came from in order to really appreciate the context and the continuity of the work that's there. And I actually love both. I love the book and I love the movie. And I think you have to treat it like a sort of, I hate to use this reference, Walking Dead. The series is very different from the comic book. It's almost two separate animals that should be appreciated. And remembering when they were written, and it might not be sort of to level to where science fiction is now, but it was a precursor for other science fiction writers. So yeah, loved it.
And my final thought is that basically, I mean, God bless Pierre Boulle for giving us Planet of the Apes to begin with, but and I enjoy the book on its own merits, but I'm always going to be a fan of the movies, and I have to sit there and say that the more and more I view it, the more I pick up on it. And it's the gift that keeps on giving, I have to sit there and say. but you know,
bundles and bundles of bananas coming your way.
And I have to sit there and say, for a film, you know, that didn't have much of a budget, you know, if you look at the budget for it, it was very, you know, very small budget. All the budget was, you know, put on the makeup. That's where the budget went to. It wasn't paid on the actors. Charlton Heston, it was his idea to bring, he was one of the people to bring it to the screen. So he took a cut in his salary and stuff like this. And, you know, and everyone sat there and they put their heart and soul in it, and it shows. And to have a movie whose message is still relevant today and still outshines, and it's going to be a movie that, you know, you got this little film from 1968 that went, you know, that started the whole franchise, started the whole merchandising thing that no other films did before that. And you got something that is still going to live on. And I say 30, 40, 50 years from now, 100 years from now, you're going to still have this film, and it's still going to resonate with this message, you know, in the future.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And it also makes you check yourself as a human being too. Again, for me, one of the things I love, that theme of, you know, we are all trying to do our own thing on this planet and trying to be better humans to other humans, but we have to encourage that with others. And also considering animals and pets, I'm a big pet lover and animal lover, and, you know, do unto others as you others would do unto you.
Who doesn't like a little competition, especially when there are prizes? Between now and September 25th, we'll be doing some giveaways for Planet of the Apes. To win one of three different action figures, Dr. Zira, Cornelius, or Dr. Zauis, make sure to leave us a review on our website, Facebook, and or Twitter page. We'll do a drawing for each action figure and post the winner on our website on September 25th. To win our grand prize, one box set of the original Planet of the Apes films on Blu-ray, post your most unique and inventive meme themed around Planet of the Apes on our Facebook or Twitter page. We will review all submissions and post the winner on our website on September 25th. All of these ape-tastic prizes are courtesy of 20th Century Fox. For more details on where to find us, go to our website at www.literary-license.com. And you can also follow us on Facebook at Literary Podcasts, as well as our Twitter page on LITLICPOD.
So what we like to do is thank, you know, Joshua, and thank John, and thank Mandy, your Literary License Podcast, and thank you for myself. My name is Keith Chawgo. Have a good night, and we'll see you next month.
Thanks, bye. Everybody.
Bye. Bye.
Bye.
All my life I've awaited your coming and dreaded it, like death itself.
Why? I've terrified you from the first, Doctor. I still do. You're afraid of me and you hate me. Why?
Because you're a man. And you're right. I have always known about man. from the evidence, I believe his wisdom must walk hand in hand with his idiocy. His emotions must rule his brain. He must be a warlike creature who gives battle to everything around him, even himself.
I need a second opinion.
You're all so lazy.
Dr. Zauis, Dr. Zauis. Dr. Zauis, Dr. Zauis. Dr. Zauis, Dr. Zauis. Oh, Dr. Zauis. Dr. Zauis, Dr. Zauis. Dr. Zauis, Dr. Zauis. Dr. Zauis, Dr. Zauis. Oh, Dr. Zauis.
Anymore.
Of course you can.
Well, I couldn't before.
Literary to the MB Literary Agency.